We are a race that is connected, a planet that has become a global village, and an audience that expects and demands. Our phones have brought us closer together and empowered a generation. But how has the same technology impacted the gatekeepers of information? Journalists. My name is James Mahan, and in this documentary, I'm investigating how the role of a journalist has and is changing due to the influence of mobile phone technology. From content gathering to distribution to always on demands, all impacted by a tool in the palm of your hand. I hear from some of the leading mobile journalists in the world and examine the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats that mobile technology is having on their professions and in their newsrooms. For this study, four unique newsrooms were chosen: STV2 in Scotland, WDEF News 12 in Tennessee, NDTV in India, and Le Monde Bleu in Switzerland. Each has been a pioneer of mobile journalism, or Mojo, but all use mobile technology in different ways and are at different stages of implementation.
The alphabet has only 26 letters. With these 26 magic symbols, however, millions of words are written every day. The Cub reporter takes information and leads on news of crime, accidents, and death from the Daily Police Record, or blotter. Although he gathers the news, the outside man often does not write the story himself, odd as this may seem. Much of the time, he stays on his beat and phones in his information.
When we were launching the mobile journalism, the biggest problem was how will we transfer the footage back to the TV station fast from remote locations.
With reporters and writers scattered all over the world, the press associations gather important news and relay it to hundreds of newspapers over special telegraph wire services.
It's just realizing that it is changing the landscape. Don't think it's little steps. This is really our iPhone video. Sometimes is the only video that we have.
News reporting is a young man's job, for the reporter must have stamina and endurance to withstand the strain of long and strenuous hours of work. He must have the courage and perseverance to get the story in spite of obstacles.
The DeZero technology is fantastic. The bonded cellular live shots, the way it changes the ability to have basically one person perform the function of three at any given time in the field.
1931. Atop the Empire State Building, the National Broadcasting Company, a service of RCA, erected the transmitting antenna for experimental television station W2XBS. Now, RCA's technicians and scientists tackled the next goal, improvement of picture quality.
This is a revolution. I mean, shooting on phones like you are doing, we also do it. We have started doing it in our studios also. Our news telecast, our news broadcast is done on these kind of cameras, the phone cameras.
Yes, in little more than a wink of time, television has entered our homes, our lives, imprinted new silhouettes on our skyline. And all this has been just the beginning. There was still another dream to be realized. Still another dimension to be added. Black and white television had been the herald. It put millions of TV sets into our homes, built hundreds of TV stations, created an industry, an art, a public service, an exhilarating component of our American way of life.
Until we are able to spread the word about visual literacy, media literacy, what it means to tell the truth, what it truly means to be a journalist, and to be a journalist is not just holding a mobile phone.
From newspapers to radio, to black and white television, to color television, and then onto satellite. The journey of what is a journalist and what is broadcasting is changing constantly. And now we're in the world of new media and mobile journalism.
इसके बारे में डिटेल में बात करना बनता है तो डिटेल में बात करेंगे हमारी इलेक्शन स्पेशल कवरेज वोट इज वोक में चलिए शुरू करते हैं
grâce à laquelle il a été possible de construire une culture
il I think we've seen a lot of discussion about the role of journalism in the modern era. Because it's so easy, anyone can be a journalist now. You don't need expensive equipment. You can do it from a bog standard smartphone. So the journalism, though, is the ability, I think, to be able to see a story, take in the facts, and then be able to retell that story in a way that everyone can tap into.
It's completely transformed what we do. So when I first started in a newsroom, we shared a mobile phone. We had to sign it out. We had 3, Earth, Wind and Fire. And that was, you know, the level of our mobile phone use. And, you know, it was literally for contacting the office to tell them, I'm coming back, I'm safe. Now we go out and we can broadcast from our mobile phone. We're sending material back. We're in constant communication through apps such as WhatsApp. I remember there were some floods in 2007 and that was the sort of first time I really saw the power of, you know, people giving us material. So in 1 week we had 20,000 pictures, which was unprecedented. But if you think this was a time when cameras on phones were just beginning.
Dr. Oscar Westlund, a Swedish media academic writing for the Reuters Institute at Oxford University, outlined how in 2007, Nokia started experimenting with mobile journalism kits in partnership with Reuters. He considers this the beginning of formal mobile journalism implementation. The journalists used Nokia N95s and covered sports and entertainment stories in China, America and the UK. Kirsty, who works alongside Bruce and Suzanne at STV, relies heavily on mobile journalism.
I went out for a few interviews. I was interviewing a young guy about what it's like to move from a really rural community to the city, and he was quite nervous. So when I showed up with my big camera, he was, you know, quite shy. I wasn't really getting answers out of him, but the battery ended up dying, so I had to use my phone. And he was, as soon as I pulled out my phone, he was like so much more relaxed. It wasn't as intimidating having this huge big equipment. I was like, just a casual, and it was the same interview. I'd said the same things. I was like, just a casual interview, but that room immediately, like I immediately made him so much more relaxed and so much more willing to talk, and I got such a better interview out of it.
In 2014, Romanian academic Drula explained the significance mobile journalism was having on our society. Mobile technologies are used as media tools, both for consumption and production of news, says Drula. The mobile environment permits easy and accurate identification of the audience, web traffic, and the tracking of content usage. In essence, Drula is saying that for the first time, the tool that you use to create the content is also the tool you use to consume it.
Thank you.
Everybody can film, but the journalist is important because it is the man or the woman that decides something is interesting or not, important or not, and the journalist has to be objective.
You need to be curious. You like to, you know, you like to know things. You like questions. You like questions. That's what you need. And you need to, you know, to like people.
Before we look at the strengths and weaknesses of mobile journalism, let's take a closer look at each of the case studies. STV2's structure relied on many small bureaus across Scotland contributing content to a nightly bulletin for that region, but also for the national agenda. Many of the reporters worked on their own or in pairs and small teams in each bureau, and therefore mobile journalism was a rational and reasonable suggestion to implement. Bruce McKenzie was the most experienced mobile journalist from that team. WDEF News 12 have been using mobile journalism since 2011 and are one of the first pioneers of the use of Digero live streaming technology in Tennessee. WDEF News 12 have also used mobile journalism during breaking news situations, including tornadoes and terrorist attacks, in order to get content out there as quickly as possible. The rationale behind choosing NDTV lay in 3 key areas. Primarily, they are a major international news organisation who have chosen to adopt Mojo. Secondary to this is their pioneering use of vertical live streaming and shooting to create the world's first only millennial video news channel called Hop Live. Finally, the demanding news agendas in late April and May 2019 offered a window into one of the world's mobile journalism leaders during peak output and operating at full capacity during their election coverage. Finally, Le Monde Bleu had been a European leader in mobile journalism when they decided to trial going mobile only in the summer of 2015. Their approach of upskilling their communities, their audiences and other news organisations globally means they actually devolve the skill set of mobile journalism to everyone around them.
Même un nouveau contrat.
C'est la fin de ce journal de l'été, merci de l'avoir suivi. On se retrouve demain, toujours du côté du Paléo. Excellente soirée sur Le Monde Bleu.
Some of the strengths of mobile journalism based on my research include autonomy, with reporters having more independence. Mobile journalism is also more cost-effective for stations, and it enhances live broadcasting output.
With the mobile phone, they can shoot just about anywhere. They get into an auto rickshaw, and they can shoot. They don't need to carry the heavy cameras. They don't need to travel with a camera team, an audio person, and all that. They're a team in themselves.
Well, in the old way, there used to be funnels of going through assignment desk, a keeper of paper files a lot of times, and organizers of stuff like that. And now we're finding that the person who is reporting on a story has much more control over the information they have. So they're not just gathering information in the field by talking to original sources. They can also get all the background they need in their hand, basically. They can do it all themselves. And it also makes it the transmission of information from the field to the newsroom and turning it back around to the public is much quicker because it can be done from the person in the field and not have to go through several different channels again.
Tells me that the man went missing last week. His body was found yesterday and there are two suspects in the case, but it's very much still an ongoing investigation.
For example, we've had some really bad weather recently, and quite often in that situation, the option of driving back to base to cut things has not been an option. Quite often I've not been able to even get to somewhere where I could send the stuff from, so to be able to do it from the phone just allowed me to quickly shoot things, quickly pick up interviews and get them sent back to Glasgow and be back out covering my patch.
For instance, I do a really long commute in the morning. It takes about 2 hours for me to get in, so a lot of the time I'm on the train. But I've got my mobile with me, so from that I can use social media, I can like look at other outlets, what's other radio stations, TV doing, clips from phones, people putting things on Twitter, and from that I can take content and create my news agenda if there's a particularly good story that maybe someone's put on, and I would be able to do that without my mobile, so I think that definitely relates back to it.
That's why smartphones and light equipments and lightness is so precious, is such a value, to be light, to be free in a way, and free in the mind, to get some intelligence, to get some freshness, to think about what we're doing.
Person and the mobile phone to the location, you might not be able to get a huge truck. Doesn't matter. You can broadcast live from your mobile phone. So it's completely transformed what we do and how we do it.
The DeZero technology is fantastic. The bonded cellular live shots, the way it changes the ability to have basically one person perform the function of three at any given time in the field.
All right, so this teacher was facing drug charges yesterday, and now she's facing more felony charges stemming from a sexual relationship that she has with a student. The school district says that she has turned in her letter of resignation.
And you know, at times when you are at a spot where the camera can't reach, but you have a mobile, so you can shoot what's basically unfolding inside also. You can get some shots, you can get some shots of people meeting each other, people meeting, people talking, you know. There are some meetings which are always taboo for a camera, so there my mobile phone helps. And obviously I'm first with the news because I can do OBs immediately. As soon as I get the news, I can, you know, just uplink those shots and I can just come online and just start talking about the issue.
They're shooting in HD, they're shooting in 4K on location, they have the in-house built utility, they can send the footage back to the TV station very easily. All they have to find a better cell phone signal somewhere. They have two SIM cards of two different cell phone operators, a MiFi device with the third mobile operator. So somewhere or the other, they will find a cell phone network good enough for them to send the footage back.
All 4K studies rely heavily on social media to provide live broadcasting output, whether it's Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or through Snapchat.
We try to do something really catchy for social networks. When we can do a Facebook Live, when we can go live also on Instagram or put things on Twitter, we do that. But we never forget that people are mainly watching us through TV. That's the root of our audience.
Satellite truck cost $450, something like that. And you had to have CDL to drive it, and it's huge and won't go through a tunnel and won't go down this street because there's trees overhanging and it'll bang the dish or the antenna. And now you can do the same thing in a small hatchback with a thing that's the size of a laptop computer.
This is a revolution. I mean, shooting on phones like you are doing, we also do it. We have started doing it in our studios also. Our news telecast, our news broadcast is done on these kind of cameras, the phone cameras. So this has really taken news a level up.
Despite the cost-saving element to mobile journalism for all the stations, Shittage confirms that it does not affect the quality of their news output.
So what we're doing is we're shooting the entire news in 4K, actually. We're not shooting in HD, we're not shooting in SD. We are shooting the entire news in 4K on the Samsung mobile phones. And the reporter on the field, then after shooting in 4K, then he down converts, he or she down converts the 4K footage into HD and then sends them across to NDTV. Now, why we do this is that the 4K footage converted to HD is much superior in quality than a conventional HD footage.
All of the TV stations use apps, which are also cost-effective, with many free and available to use on Apple or Android devices.
So, for example, we use WhatsApp all the time. We have a constant WhatsApp group for our newsroom in Glasgow, where you can constantly be feeding information back in. You're not waiting to speak to one person. You can feed information in, and the programme teams can all see the information you're sending in. So it's great in that respect. That might be to say, use the second answer from this clip because and here are the in-words for somebody. It might be to feed in caption details, but it might also be you've turned up for a press launch, quick snap of a press release, and you can send that, and then everyone in the newsroom can see it at once. So it's definitely made a big difference in that respect. Also, when you're liaising with crews, so if you're trying to meet up with a producer or a camera crew or the satellite van when we're doing a live, you can drop a pin from Google Maps and they'll be able to find you very quickly. And again, in terms of delivering our stories to our digital team for the web pages, we can quite quickly again get still shots from a scene or little video clips that we can supply to them, and they can have them online very quickly.
Now, there are some drawbacks or weaknesses to mobile journalism. One of those being its technical limitations, with phone lenses, framing, lighting, and a number of other issues arising. Also infrastructure concerns and restrictions based on 4G and 5G, and also alienation, with journalists feeling left out or removed from a newsroom environment.
Yes, technology is changing every day. I will say it's changing much faster than we could have ever imagined. I think one should go step by step and not jump into complete transformation into a mobile journalism or mobile shooting through mobiles. Mobile cameras have their limitations. There are certain amount of limitations regarding the framing, and you have to be very close to the subject. So in news organizations, it works to a certain extent, but for features, it becomes difficult.
You cannot make like great image because many times it's night when I do things, when I work, it's night, and at night this is not so well.
No,
and there's no Zoom. I need Zoom when there's some firemen, you know, on top of a building, and I can go to the building and need to film the fireman on top of the building. With that, we cannot do it.
Les enfants seront scolarisés, et donc il y aura...
The one drawback of using the iPhone versus using a traditional camera is that it's not as versatile. It doesn't allow you quite as much control, particularly of the shot. I use an adapter to plug a decent quality mic in and a preamp, so the sound's always good. But it is a problem sometimes just having the full control of the shot. For example, if you're trying to zoom into things, it's never quite as good. And also, if the light's moving around a lot, it's not as easy as just grabbing the iris ring on a traditional VGA camera to be able to just adjust the exposure a bit quite quickly.
Bruce McKenzie, who's at Rugby Park. Bruce.
Good evening, Roman. Yes, this is an ambitious appointment by Kilmarnock. The club, of course, appointing its ninth manager in 8 years and looking for a bit of stability. That was a word mentioned today both by the new manager, Steve Clark, and also by the Kilmarnock chairman, Billy Bowie.
Quite a lot of technical problems. Connectivity, 4G was not so good at the time, and there was some very crowded places, we had some very bad connectivity.
When we were launching the mobile journalism, the biggest problem was how will we transfer the footage back to the TV station fast from remote location. So our software engineering team came up with this idea. They made a small utility and on the web, and they provided logins to all the reporters. So now a reporter on location has to just log in onto that utility on the browser, select the file from the mobile phone, and it automatically gets transferred through the cloud servers to the TV station, our NDTV servers, and within a few minutes, at times within a few seconds, if you have a great cell phone bandwidth or a great Wi-Fi signal, then within seconds, the footage is here in our TV station servers. And the moment the footage comes here, an automated email gets sent out to the input department and to the producers concerned, and they automatically get alerted, and they immediately pull out the footage, and it's on air in no time.
Once again, more evidence.
Take live on, guys.
On the gesture of the
Thailand 4 and Thailand Bizarre.
So eventually, it took us a lot of time to get acclimatized or accommodated to the new system and the new workflow. The file formats are an issue, but with latest codecs and other things available, and a lot of stuff being done on YouTube and other channels also. I think we have come a long way, so there's nothing to worry about.
A theme that arose during my participant observation and research with all four of the case studies was that of alienation. Many mobile journalists spend significant amounts of time alone, without a newsroom, away from their colleagues. Mary Angela Bach, professor at the University of Austin, Texas, is one of a few journalists who's raised this issue.
Working alone has a number of safety drawbacks. Doing a live shot on the side of the road is not safe when one is alone. Doing a live shot with equipment around you near a crowd is also not safe. So again, just because somebody can do something alone, just because it's cheaper, doesn't always mean that it is safe. They are in considerable danger, from mischief makers to actual political operatives wishing to do them harm. And so I think that as the mobile journalism revolution continues, organizations and journalism groups need to address the safety factor as well.
Dr. Christopher Holt also cautions against this one-person newsroom approach.
You're a traveling journalistic one-man band, doing everything yourself. And that, of course, takes away the, you know, the normal feeling of belonging.
Dennis Palma at Le Monde Bleu believes there are a number of drawbacks to mobile journalism, but that newsrooms should use it in a convergence capacity.
It's not only mobile journalism, it's not only classic journalism. We have to mix up everything to be able to adapt yourself to the situations.
Through Mojo, there are now more opportunities to create a greater range of content. Audiences are also able to contribute and feel part of the news gathering process. And these same audiences now have a wider selection of news to choose from. In this next part of the documentary, I examine how these new Mojo facilitated opportunities are helping to empower and equip media creators and consumers.
We had much more options and to play around with the footage, because obviously your satellite time is restricted with the cost. So there was a limited amount of footage we were getting. Over here we were getting much more footage through mobile uploads over the cloud, and it was more or less there on the cloud. If you miss out any clip, or if I want to use any clip slightly later in life, then I could have just pulled it again.
I really believe that we have different types of audience. One especially related to TV, another one especially related to social media, and maybe there is a third category that willingly goes on our website.
Like, there was a study that says young people aren't watching the news as much, and it's not because we're not interested in news. We definitely are. We want to know what's going on about us, but it's how we're taking that in. And most people that I know are taking that in through social media now, which is like through trends, so hashtags, or just like they'll follow news accounts they trust, and that's how they pick up their news. So I think it definitely impacts, because that's how most young people now are receiving their news.
Trustees of the organisation decided its partnerships with the oil company were at odds with their commitment to tackling climate change. Laura Alderman is outside the National Gallery in Edinburgh.
Well, it's not unusual for large oil companies like BP to sponsor massive arts events like the BP Portrait Award, which happens every year here in Edinburgh and is extremely popular.
I've stopped reading broadsheet, you know, now these days I only connect with news through my mobile phone. So obviously online is a big issue, big, you know, kind of medium for India also. And for us also at NDTV, we are supposed to, you know, break stories online first.
With satellite restriction is no longer being an issue, an audience is now going to online first and receiving that content through their mobile phone. NDTV created the world's first vertical live streaming news channel to bring news for a millennial generation into the palms of their audience's hands.
Nowhere in the world is there anything like this. With special technology, NDTV Hop streams live on your phone. To download it, go to your App Store or Play Store or hop.live.
I hop, do you?
I hop, do you?
A country is so diverse that you have so much of content going on every single day. So it's very important that content reaches the right kind of audience and in the most interesting way. Indian media has been really good in delivering the news. But now I think the time demands for it to be delivered in an interesting way. And that's what I like to do with my stories or shows.
Like, so simple nowadays, we're using, like, we are not using those big cameras, and we're using these small phones, which is like so handy, where it will take like hardly 15-20 minutes for a shoot,
This is such a huge country. Mm-hmm. Do you find that your market is much bigger than just Delhi, that there are people who watch what you guys do in other places?
Yes, definitely. Because, see, we don't restrict ourselves when it comes to shooting and meeting with people and shooting with them. So, for example, we have a show called Tuesday Travels where we go to different locations. So, we've shot in Chandigarh, we've shot in Mumbai, all over India. So, yeah, we've got a lot of people, you know. So, that's how people know about the app. I know it's new, but then people are getting to know about it. And the best part is because it's on the phones, it works the best for us.
Professor Bach queries whether NDTV Hop Live is a glimpse of the future of our news world.
As time goes on, whether we're going to end up with kind of old person news on horizontal and new news vertical, and if just the way Facebook is kind of floating away in the distance and TikTok is taking over, I wonder if what format we use and watch is also going to demarcate generations in their consumption of news.
Younger audiences are consuming news differently in India due to Hop Live. But what about when the audience actually creates the content themselves?
We have some more experience. We can teach the people how to edit, how to shoot, and teach them that. We give them some skills, some new skills to the people, and we create communities. And those communities give us back what we give them. And that's the way we are slowly creating communities in Geneva. We have ONGs, we have sports clubs to shoot, to edit, and then they shoot, they edit, and they bring us back all the videos, all the contents. We create a centrality. We are now like Facebook. The people send us their contents. That's very new. That's very cool.
While Le Monde Bleu are upskilling and teaching audiences how to become mobile journalists, political parties in India are already creating the content themselves.
Because I went to a rally of Prime Minister Modi in Meerut, 3 hours away from Delhi, and there were more people holding what you're holding, a selfie stick with a phone, than media cameras. And they were all from the BJP's social media team of that city.
A huge in number, even bigger than the Muslim community, which is why it's going to be interesting to see whether they turn up and vote for the Congress, with whom they've had a strained relationship, particularly in this area, with the background of the 1984 riots.
Video wars, we saw that, how each political party has now got a war room of social media, and we as journalists have to be able to counter that with the accurate information. Because it's not like they're always spreading fake news, they are, but they're also just giving it that kind of an incomplete picture, which is enough to mislead the public who sees it either on WhatsApp, on Facebook, on Twitter, or any other platform.
With Le Monde Bleu upskilling their audiences to be mobile journalists in Switzerland, and political parties in India creating their own content, leading media academics Thurman and Carlson encourage the move towards user-generated content, and believe in many of it stems from citizen journalism. Thurman used the example of a Scottish newspaper when explaining that if it wasn't for user-generated content, a newspaper would lose out on 5 to 7 stories a day. While Holt and Carlson suggest that social media interaction between journalists and consumers has a positive effect on political participation and therefore can have a more significant impact on society.
His assets are going to be frozen. This is going to be seen as a big diplomatic win for India.
WDF News 12 in America and NDTV in India have found that mobile phones have given them opportunities to provide news coverage that normally they would not be able to deliver.
A plane crash at a local airport where we were not getting any official information from official sources about what had happened, but by actually seeing the pictures that the reporter was sending back through the iPhone, and even though she didn't have anyone giving her information, by seeing the pictures, you still have information that helps bridge the gap there.
This one was one of my favorites, so that's why I'm going to tell this story. But it was a car chase that happened in Atlanta. The 10-mile car chase ended on the highway, and I was able to get a really good picture of the car because I could take my little iPhone and get it through the gate to get a picture. Your camera can't do that. So I was able to truly tell the story of the damage that was done to this car because we had really good images, and that could only happen with a cell phone.
And I would say it has become more accessible. Like if I'm not working, I'm on leave, and I find something newsworthy, I don't have to wait for my camera person to come and shoot it. I can shoot it on my phone and send it to my office, and they can use that info. So this way, it has become very easy to, you know, provide news and through Mojo journalism, and for people, the digital audience, I mean, sky's the limit.
When reflecting on the opportunities that mobile journalism creates, the core focus returns once again to the theme of what audiences want, with them now being more involved than ever before. Chan Olmsted, Rim and Zerba in 2012 asked why young audiences are turning away from traditional media, and concluded that the main factors influencing this trend were relative content advantage, relative technology advantage, and relative cost advantage. Chan Olmsted, Rim and Zerba present online journalism as infinite, not limited to a broadcast minute cap or column inch restriction. Therefore, the space afforded to storytelling is greater and access is easier for younger, more tech-comfortable audiences. Since mobile news is often the mobile version of online news, the perceived advantage of unlimited content might also be present for this news platform. Romanian academic Drula refers to a Google study where 1/3 of phone users admitted to happily giving up TV in order to keep their mobile device. While there are many strengths to Mojo, a number of weaknesses and plenty of opportunities, the transition to mobile technology also creates a series of threats to traditional journalism, primarily in job loss.
They do all here. Journalists film, edit, put the material on the social media, they put it on the TV, They put the stuff on the website, so it's very challenging every day.
As far as the information that we are getting, our source of information is the CRPF, and the CRPF is saying that this area belongs to Maharashtra Police because Maharashtra Police is deployed there, and it's not the CRPF which is deployed there. And as far as the number of casualties are concerned, they are saying that the kind of impact the blast had, the kind of impact, you know, you can see it in the visual.
The Reuters Digital News Report for 2019 highlights job losses in print and broadcast outlets across the world, from Australia to Argentina. Dr. Ivo Borum, a Mojo pioneer and academic, highlighted in the book he wrote with Stephen Quinn that the mobile journalism evolution is affecting the job market. Job losses can be the result of new technology and lead to reluctance to embrace new communications. When NDTV switched to Mojo, 70 employees lost their jobs. This push to replace 3 craft professionals with 1 Mojo can create other challenges.
We make some mistakes sometimes, but we always try to adapt. It's always moving. It's quite hard to keep track of everything, of every digital changes and changes in technologies as well. But we try our best to satisfy also our audience that might be a little older on TV and younger on social medias.
I believe that there's a lot of people today that gather news and get informed through social media and the internet, which is a good thing and at the same time can be a bad thing. Not to mention the death of TV, like what are we going to do? But that's, I guess, how our life is and how we should evolve.
It offers a lot of possibilities, but it also puts a lot of strain on individual journalists because they have to do everything, which for especially older journalists, that is a transition phase that can be difficult, but also for younger people, the pressure to deliver content and to edit and to have sound and video and text and all of that, you know, you're doing the job of 3 or 4 people only as one person. That puts a strain, and I've heard, you know, and we've seen this in research also, that many journalists think that this is a bit too much, you know, and you're also supposed to update your Twitter accounts, your Facebook accounts, your Instagram accounts, and if you're not present on all of these platforms, and if you're not always constantly sending in stuff, you know, you feel like you're slipping behind.
The 2018 Ofcom report, entitled A Decade of Digital Dependency, aligns with the concerns and themes raised in this research. The shift from traditional media to mobile has been significant between 2008 and 2018. In the UK, 2/3 of adults now say the internet is an essential part of their life. While those listening to digital radio has increased, desktop usage has dropped by 40%. Around 1/3 of people say they feel either cut off or lost without the internet if they can't get online, and 17% say they find it stressful. Half of all UK adults say their life would be boring if they could not access the internet, according to the same Ofcom report. Over the last 10 years, increased internet speeds, the rise of social media, and the evolution of mobile phone technology have altered how and where we consume news. The American news outlet WDEF News 12 admit this always-on journalism and increasing content demand enabled by Mojo is putting their newsroom under pressure.
Long term, you're going to have to just produce content as a news organization and put it out there. And the viewer is going to say, okay, here's the lineup of stories that I want to know. I want to know what happened at city council. I want to know what the traffic is like. I want to know what the weather's like. I always want to know what the weather's like. That's the lifeblood of local news, is local weather.
What we're feeling now from the people who are consuming our news in the United States at any rate is they don't seem to want anymore that unbiased viewpoint of the news. They say they do, but by their feedback, they don't. They want news that is friendly to what their take is on the world.
We're here to give both sides of every single thing that we can, every story we touch, to the best of our ability. You can't balance them all, but we try. That's our job, is to give it to them and let them make their decision. We know that when you get in the business for a while, you can tell when a journalist is trying to sway you into thinking one way or another. And it's done every single day. The average person doesn't quite catch on, but they're getting there. They're beginning to look and see that a journalist, for instance, can leave out one simple little part, and suddenly the whole story changes completely.
I reached out to Marsha Blackburn for her reaction. Her press secretary sent a statement reiterating her campaign stance that Bredesen will just be another vote for Chuck Schumer and Obama-era policies.
Bienvenue dans ce nouveau journal de l'été. J'espère que vous avez passé un excellent week-end.
Les monteurs du Paléo ont dû faire face aux températures caniculaires de ces dernières semaines.
Like, one of the big issues here is jobs. At least, that's what we're learning. But again, the other issues, like illegitimate colonies, they continue to be important to talk about.
For Stuart, potholes are an escalating occupational hazard. More than 100 driving instructors across Ayrshire have joined up to push for improvements.
All four case studies explained that mobile journalism implementation has come at a price. But now they are on this mobile journalism path, their biggest challenge will be to keep up.
We have to be aware of what is happening within the industry and developments with the technology. It's about picking the right things to go with. I think a lot of people initially, when they were live broadcasting apps, they picked one, whereas a lot of people picked another live broadcasting app, and one sort of fallen away quite quickly, another one fell away soon after that, then there was Facebook Live. So it's about putting your money into the things that, you know, will work, but not investing in everything, but keeping abreast of technological changes so that, you know, we are adept, we're fast moving and things like that.
Some of the companies are actually driving the development, but for the most part, I would say it's reactive.
We have to try to be good everywhere, in every part of this new world and this new content consumption.
Being able to be visually literate is fast becoming a human right in the 21st century. But at the same time, we have a lot of folks who are participating in online communication who do not wish their communities well. And until we are able to spread the word about visual literacy, media literacy, what it means to tell the truth, what it truly means to be a journalist. And to be a journalist is not just holding a mobile phone.
This documentary questioned whether mobile phone technology was and is changing the role of a journalist. With tighter budgets, more live content expectations, and always-on journalism, newsrooms are altering how they tell news based on the influence of Mojo. This in turn gives reporters more autonomy and independence, but also leaves them alienated and disconnected. While smartphone technology continues to evolve, technical limitations, file formats, and coverage issues present stumbling blocks for some news outlets. As our newsrooms decrease in size, but content output increases, this documentary has shown that Mojo can help bridge the gap, but also can leave many journalists behind, leaving them without jobs. Mojo also places more demands on journalists who are now doing three jobs in one to satisfy audiences across TV, online, and social media who continue to expect and demand.
1A in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.